My name is Thais Gibson, and I'm the co-owner and creator of the Personal Development School. This is your Daily Breakthrough video, and in this video, I'm going to take you through your attachment style test. So keep in mind, I do have a link in the description box below that can provide you with a long-form report, as well as a video specifically on just your attachment style. But what I want to do in this specific video is take you through some really key components of each of the four major attachment styles and help you understand some of the childhood patterns that would be there, as well as adult behavioral patterns, feelings, and emotional patterns on a regular basis, as well as thought and belief patterns that will help you to really see into yourself and gain insight as to which attachment style you are. So you can start by thinking of your attachment style as basically existing along a continuum in a way. You might have different patterns related to more than one style. So for example, you might not just be secure. You could be primarily secure, but have anxious components to your attachment style. So have more moments, core wounds, anxieties, fears related to being anxious, preoccupied. And I'm going to explain what all of this means. But I want you to know we do have a primary attachment style and are mostly governed by a primary attachment style, and then a little bit influenced by our secondary attachment style or any other patterns we might have. So the example we could think of is a fearful avoidant who maybe also has that anxious side. Okay, so they could be very in their avoidant moments, but lean anxious from time to time. So you sort of are rooted in one, but can carry traits of the other. And this will be primarily what influences your personality and the subconscious rules you play by in a relationship dynamic. So what I've developed is something called integrated attachment theory, which basically overlaps the original John Bowlby's work with subconscious core wounds, our subconscious expectations in a relationship for what it should look like, how it should feel, how it should go, our subconscious needs we carry in a relationship, as well as some of our emotional patterns we might see and ways through which we give and receive love. So let's start by looking at our securely attached person. And what I want you to do as you hear all of these four main components is think of what your childhood was like in these experiences, and then think of, you know, what other components you might have in here, okay? Do I exhibit some of these adult patterns in my relationships? Do I have some of, you know, fearful avoidant or dismissive avoidant as a secondary attachment style? So really take a look, and it might even be useful for you to write notes about some of this if you're really curious and diving more deeply in. So first and foremost, our securely attached child often gets a lot of positive reinforcement around their needs and their feelings during their upbringing. So there is a caregiver who is attentive consistently enough, not perfect, but consistently enough, that the child learns that my feelings are safe to express and in fact are worthy of being expressed because in fact, when I do express them, I have positive reinforcement. If I cry, my caregiver comes towards me, nurtures me, soothes me, these sorts of things. So we get this caregiver who consistently acknowledges your feelings, consistently meets your needs, or at least holds space for the need to be there. As you get a little bit older, maybe negotiates those needs more, but listens to you, sees your needs, makes your needs feel valid and worthy of being expressed. Now, as a byproduct of this, what a child receives is the belief that they can be loved for who they are. They feel loved unconditionally in a sense because they are loved literally for their feelings, for their needs. They don't feel like they have to earn love or you know, garner it from some sort of behavior that they take part in or through positive reinforcement. And then other times they get a lot of negative reinforcement. They feel like just who they are is worthy of love. So this child grows up and they feel naturally more worthy. They feel more confident. They feel like they can trust in relationships. They feel like it's safe to express themselves. It's safe to share their needs with other people and vice versa, because they've been taught that this is how healthy behavior is modeled. And so this is what they also give to other individuals because it's part of their programming. So, you know, there aren't a tremendous amount of people who are exclusively secure nowadays. And I understand that I see that from my sample size of the population, but some research shows it's around 50% of the population. I would argue a very large portion of those people are self-reporting. And often what I've seen personally in my practice is that people will say to me, oh, I'm definitely mostly secure. But as we dig a little more deeply into their patterns, they're actually mostly anxious or mostly dismissive avoidant. And they might have stable enough relationship patterns, but they've got a lot more of these different attachment styles in there. Everybody has an attachment style, by the way, whether you are aware of it or not, every single person has one. So that is our securely attached individual. Then in this person's adult life, they'll often have healthier, thriving relationships. They often feel safe communicating all these different things. Then if we look at the three insecurely attached individuals, what we will see is that on one end of the continuum, in a way, we have our dismissive avoidant. And the dismissive avoidant is the person in childhood who often goes through some form of emotional neglect. Now, it can also be physical neglect, where literally this child is neglected and has neglectful parents. But much more often than not, it's sort of under the radar emotional neglect, where the child's physical needs will be very well met. They're cooked for, they have food on the table, they have a safe home, a roof over their head, structure in their life, these sorts of things. But the emotional component of nurturing is missing. And it can be that this is because there are two, you know, more avoidant parents. It can be that one parent's avoidant and the other parent's working all the time. There can be these different dynamics that play out. Basically, as a result of this, a child grows up in an environment where they have an inherent part of themselves. Our emotions are literally a part of our identity at a subconscious level, an inherent part of our being. And they keep wanting to connect over that and get nurtured emotionally and connect and share their feelings. And if those things are constantly repressed or diminished, a child doesn't have the ability consciously to recognize, oh, my parents are emotionally unavailable. So what happens instead is this child basically grows up to go, oh, there must be something wrong with me, because this inherent part of me, this intrinsic part of myself, my identity, when I try to show it, it keeps getting rejected consistently enough that I must be wrong. And so this individual usually grows up with a really strong defectiveness wound, this core belief that I am defective or something's wrong with me. And they have other wounds that come as a byproduct of this. Core wounds or beliefs being things like, you know, it's unsafe to be vulnerable. I am unsafe connecting with other people. I'm trapped or helpless or powerless in some of my interpersonal relationship dynamics. And so those are some of the big stories and narratives that this person carries about themselves and the world at a subconscious level. And as a byproduct of a lot of this, what you'll often see is this person grows up in their adult life or lives to these individuals to basically like really fear intimacy. Because you have to imagine, if you constantly get intimacy rejected as a child, all of your subconscious associations built in there, like intimacy is scary. Intimacy doesn't feel like it's a safe thing to practice. So emotional intimacy is specifically what I mean. But there will be all these barriers to this. So you'll see this adult often fear commitment, fear too much emotional closeness, not want to settle down in relationships, maybe seem like they want to settle down at a conscious level, but then have all these sort of sabotaging strategies to keep people away. They often don't really want to be seen for who they are deeply, because they have a core belief that you'll see that something's wrong with me or I am defective. So they'll keep people at arm's length, very much value their privacy, so on and so forth. And so it's important to recognize, for those of us who have friends or family members or people we know like this, you know, it's really easy to judge it at a surface level, but what's actually happening underneath is the person is actually responding to usually childhood trauma that's been unresolved and that was actually a really painful experience for them at some point in their lives. And still can continue to be to a certain degree to this day, though they might have adapted to it and not necessarily fully recognized that this is all of what's taking place. So that's one end of the continuum. The other end of the continuum is our anxious, preoccupied attachment style individual. And this person usually grows up with some kind of perceived abandonment in their childhood. Now, perceived abandonment can have a really powerful impact in a not very nice way, especially if there's consistent exposure to it. So because of some kind of inconsistency in the emotional nurturing process, what often happens is a child will have all these positive emotional associations to connecting, where they have a stable enough caregiver, where they feel like they can get love from that caregiver, but then maybe the caregiver works a lot. Or maybe one caregiver is really loving and nurturing and the other one's not really that available. And that juxtaposition creates a perceived abandonment. Now, This can also be the result of a real abandonment. So, for example, being given up for adoption, things like this. But those, you know, more intensive abandonments are actually a little more likely to create some strong, fearful, avoidant tendencies because they're a much larger and more profound trauma. Somebody could still be rooted in anxious going through that, but lean very fearful avoidant, or even be a fearful avoidant with a strong anxious side. So it's important to just be aware of those nuanced differences. Now, the anxious preoccupied individual, because of this consistent perceived abandonment programmed into their nervous system and the pain that comes with that, they often feel very afraid of abandonment occurring in their adult lives. So they often have really strong core wounds going, I will be abandoned, I will be alone, I'm not good enough. They often make that abandonment or inconsistency mean that it's something about them, they're not good enough. I will be rejected, I will be excluded, I don't belong, or I'm disliked. And while that may not be the experience that an anxious, preoccupied individual has in their adult life, because often they become quite charming as sort of a coping mechanism to connect and maintain that connection, if these things happen, even at a small sort of micro form, so for example, they feel a little bit excluded from a group of their friends at lunchtime, you know, where some people might navigate that and just go, oh, you know, this happens sometimes, it's part of social interactions and dynamics. An anxiously attached individual with this core wound is likely to really feel that in a very strong and painful way. And so we'll see this individual in their adult lives, because of these subconscious programs, always yearning and longing for that emotional hunger of getting closer and closer in relationships. And what that yearning actually is it's a subconscious strategy to fill a need. It's a subconscious strategy to get closer because of this pain point that we're trying to avoid, since the brain is wired to avoid pain from childhood. So this anxious, preoccupied individual will often go out of their way in their adult lives to try to keep getting closer to people. And sometimes this can actually be something that pushes people away, because sometimes this can feel codependent to people. And in fact, it can be quite codependent to a certain degree. And so what will happen is we will sometimes see these individuals in their adult lives as the ones that are needy or clingy or always want more closeness or call repeatedly or things like this. And again, just like the dismissive avoidant, it's easy to judge that at a surface level, but what's actually happening is their subconscious trauma is being activated because of these core belief patterns and painful wounds and unmet needs that really need to be reprogrammed in order to heal and in order to have those thriving and healthy relationships. And then our very last attachment style is the fearful avoidant. Now, the fearful avoidant is also sometimes referred to as the anxious avoidant or the disorganized attachment style. And while I've learned from the research I've done, you know, and the programs I've done to talk about fearful avoidant as fearful avoidant, I actually prefer the terminology anxious avoidant or disorganized more. And I'll tell you why. The fearful avoidant, aka anxious avoidant, they actually experience both sides of that sort of attachment continuum we were discussing. So they have the ability to feel very anxious and to have all of those core wounds and triggers that the anxious, preoccupied person has, where they can fear abandonment and being alone and being excluded, and they can go through some immense pain over that. But they also experience the dismissive, the avoidant side of the attachment spectrum. And so they can have that very strong, oh my goodness, I feel trapped, I feel helpless, I feel powerless, you know, something's wrong with me, or I am defective. They can experience a lot of shame. But combined with that, the fearful avoidant or anxious avoidant also carries two other really profound core wounds. And these two other core wounds are, I am bad. And while the fearful avoidant often won't recognize this in their internal dialogue or in their thoughts about themselves, if you pay close attention, this individual goes out of their way the vast majority of their adult lives to do anything to avoid being bad, and feels a tremendous amount of guilt and shame if they think they hurt someone's feelings or do something wrong or are bad in any form. And so that's really important to recognize. And the other big core wound, which is probably the single most prevalent core wound, is I will be betrayed or I can't trust. And this brings me back to that idea of the disorganized attachment style individual, where we talked about how the other name for it can be called the disorganized one. And the reason for this, or the reason this really makes sense, is that there is a disorganized attachment strategy. So there is no real, solid, consistent attachment strategy that the fearful avoidant, aka anxious avoidant, aka disorganized attachment person has. And part of this is because usually in their upbringing, there's some kind of consistent trauma that's taking on an inconsistent form. What does that mean? Well, what this really means is there can be a fearful avoidant person who grows up and the environment they're in has a caregiver or multiple caregivers who are extremely unpredictable. And this can be for many different reasons. This could be because there's a lot of fighting in the home. This could be because there's a lot of parental alienation happening in the home where one parent's constantly turning the other parent against a child or vice versa. Or this can even be things like the caregiver being an alcoholic, an addict, somebody who's abusive, anything like that. And I want to give you an example of this to really illustrate this. Let's pretend that you grow up and let's say one of your caregivers is an alcoholic. As a child, you want the love from your caregivers. We're inherently wired for that. But that inconsistency of not knowing, oh, is this person drinking? Are they going to be safe? Are they not safe today because they're drinking? Are they going to be mean because they're drinking? Are they going to be nice because they're drinking? That total chaos of trying to determine a person's behavior creates the disorganized attachment strategy. There's no order and structure. There's no, we look at the dismissive avoidant, there's consistent emotional neglect. So that person basically adapts to that by learning to just hyper self-soothe and keep people at a distance. The anxious preoccupied goes, oh my gosh, I can consistently soothe through my caregivers when they're here. The disorganized individual or fearful avoidant, anxious avoidant individual, they grow up and they go, I can't predict anybody's behavior. I can't trust at all. And so this becomes one of their huge core wounds. And they really go out of their way in life to become hypervigilant, really good at predicting behavioral patterns, really attuned to other people. And it's actually a coping mechanism due to some of the unresolved trauma. So the fearful avoidant as a byproduct of this often in their adult lives becomes the very hot and cold partner. Sometimes they're warm, sometimes they're cold. And it's actually mimicking their early subconscious programs around what love was. Sometimes love was warm, sometimes love was cold and painful. And this person usually really wants love, but is terrified of it at a subconscious level at the same time. And so they have those all those core wounds, and they often are in this push-pull dynamic and can be very confusing to somebody else who's in a relationship with them. But it's very confusing and hard to be the fearful avoidant as well, because there's a lot of distrust, but wanting connection at the same time. And there's that push-pull going on within the individual. So from all of this, okay, this is a high level, but deep enough version of learning about your different attachment styles to hopefully help you see A, some of your childhood patterns, and B, some of the different dynamics that can appear and some of the core wounds and needs. So I want you to see which one you are. I do want you to also know that our attachment style can change over time. So you could grow up secure. For example, you could be in an abusive relationship for 15 years. Hopefully nobody stays in that dynamic ever, but let's just say in theory, and you could leave that and be fearful avoidant. And the reason our attachment style can change is because we have neuroplasticity and we fire and wire new programs all the time. Old ones atrophy over time, just like how our muscles atrophy. And so, you know, things can shift around. Now, the really hopeful part of that is that we can reprogram our attachment style, and whatever attachment style we are not stuck with by any means if we're willing to put in some of the reprogramming work. And what that really consists of for everybody is reprogramming those core wounds, you know, changing those narratives you have about yourself because of the things you went through. So not making, you know, a parent's inconsistency mean that you're not good enough, but being able to change that narrative and realize where that's really coming from. And also learning to meet our needs, express our needs, advocate for our needs, and learning to develop our sense of self in terms of our boundaries, our vision, our purpose, you know, these different components. And as we go through and do some of that, we take massive steps towards becoming secure in a fairly short period of time. So this is possible for everybody. Really important to note. And of course, our attachment style can impact us not just in terms of romantic relationships, but also in terms of friendships, in terms of our co-working relationships, you know, our family. Literally every single relationship in our life is affected by our attachment style. So I hope this was valuable in terms of helping you just get that test and understanding of the different types and really see where you fall in terms of your primary. Some of you will just have a primary attachment style. Others of you might go, oh my gosh, I'm fully, fully fearful avoidant. That's it. Some people might go, I'm really, really anxious, but I definitely have like some fearful avoidant tendencies, or I have some secure tendencies. So just take a look, see where you fit. And again, we have that attachment style test below that you can take that will further help you to understand this more deeply. So thank you for being here. Thank you for watching. Please like, share, and subscribe. And I will see you in the next video.